नमस्कार एंड वेलकम टू ऑल द व्यूअर्स, द रीडर्स एंड द लिसनर्स, एंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू मैडम अंजलि चंद्रा, हु हैज स्पेयर्ड हर वैल्यूएबल टाइम टू बी विद अस. मैम इज मेंबर पंजाब स्टेट इलेक्ट्रिसिटी रेगुलेटरी कमीशन, एंड मैम हैज वेरी काइंडली एंड ग्रेशियसली एक्सेप्टेड आवर इन्विटेशन टू बी इन दिस यूनिक एंड स्पेशल एडिशन ऑफ द रेगुलेटरी डाइजेस्ट, which is the March edition. So in the tune of things, 8th of March is the International Women's Day. And in that tradition, we are bringing to you stories from eminent women who are regulators. And so ma'am is with us in that context. Ma'am brings to the table 4 decades of experience in the power sector. And we are looking forward to hearing from you, ma'am. Ma'am's area of expertise includes distribution and transmission network planning, formulating standards, devising regulatory frameworks, and load forecasting. Prior to joining PSERC, Madam Chandra was principal chief engineer at the Central Electricity Authority, where she was responsible for power survey and load forecasting, power system monitoring, project appraisal, and distribution planning and development. She has also served as Executive Director, Tariff and Engineering at the Delhi Electricity Regulatory Commission. Ma'am says that my experience in distribution and regulation helped me in becoming a member at PSERC, and the entire journey, she says, has been very fulfilling. Madam Chandra has been a member of various task forces and committees constituted by the Ministry of Power and the CEA. She was involved in the preparation of the 19th Electrical Power Survey Report, the base document for perspective planning for the sector. She has been a part of various Bureau of Indian Standard committees and has served as the chairperson of BIS's ET13 committee on meters and as a member of committees on capacitors, transformers, etc. Besides, she has been involved in planning the sub-transmission and distribution systems of Thimphu and Paro cities in Bhutan. On the introduction of new technologies in distribution, Madam Chandra says that while issuing tariff orders, the regulators have to cautiously balance costs and benefits with the emerging technology solutions. Madam is an Indian Engineering Service officer of the 1978 batch, and an electrical engineer from the Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology, and has an MBA from Punjab University. She's also a Bureau of Energy Efficiency certified energy auditor. And in 2012, ma'am received the CBIP Tag Corporation Award in 2006-07, as well as recognition from the National Council of Power Utilities for her contribution to the power sector. We're delighted and honored to have you amongst us, ma'am. And with your permission, we maybe begin asking you a few questions, ma'am, unless there is something that you'd like to begin with.
No, no. You please continue with asking questions.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So the first question that comes to mind, ma'am, and I think our readers would be interested in knowing, is that what are some of the regulatory challenges that are being faced by India at this particular point of time, at this juncture, ma'am? If you could throw some light on that.
Okay. You know, the increasing share of renewable energy in the present energy mix presents key regulatory challenges in terms of integrating the renewables as also in balancing the renewables in the grid, balancing the grid, creating ancillary services, spinning reserves, all this, and flexibility of the other other generating sources. The other regulatory challenges like protecting investments in coal capacity which have already been made by the DISCOMs. And the third challenge I think regulators face is, you know, keeping tariffs reasonable and at the same time reducing cross-subsidy and not creating regulatory assets. You know, as I feel it, it is very important to not create regulatory assets because it is very difficult to recover regulatory assets. The regulatory assets only enrich the banks. The consumer pays interest on the regulatory assets and then further interest on the interest portion. So I feel that this is the biggest challenge, that we should keep the tariffs reasonable and at the same time. Sorry, can you hear me? Yeah. Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. And at the same time, you know, keep the tariffs within the reach of the consumer. Then, you know, I think balancing the interest of all stakeholders is a very big regulatory challenge. You know, there are times when you know what is right, but it may not be in the interest of all the stakeholders. So balancing the interest of these stakeholders is very important. For example, we know that, you know, fixed costs should be borne by the consumers. But in the COVID scenario, you know, passing on fixed costs to consumers who have not even consumed one unit of energy becomes very difficult. But at the same time, DISCOM is incurring costs. So we have to balance the interest of all these stakeholders. Then I think, you know, having adequate and capable staff in the state electricity regulatory commissions is also a big challenge. You know, retaining good staff and officers in the commission is very important for the working of the commission, because, you know, the officers in the commission are very few, and the amount of monitoring, prudence check and everything which is conducted by the commissions is huge. Every commission is looking after a state or a UT, and the amount of data which can be generated from the utility and you know, monitored in the SERC requires staff with IT capabilities as well as technical and financial capabilities. You know, people who are experts in data mining at the same time having technical and financial capabilities is required in the regulatory commissions. So, you know, what is available in the market is mainly people who are either technical or financial or IT experts, but we require a combination of the three. So that is, I think, a very important challenge which commissions face in their working.
Right.
That would be another challenge I could think of. And, you know, in this time, ensuring an optimal mix of power generating sources, that is also a big regulatory challenge, because DISCOMs have entered into long-term PPAs, which are 25 years in tenure. At the same time, we, you know, the load profile is such, for example, in Punjab, we require power for 4 months to the tune of 13,000 megawatt, and in the other 8 months, we may be requiring only 6,000 to 7,000, and at night we require, say, 5,000 to 6,000. So ensuring a proper mix of power generating sources has become a regulatory challenge. You know, when the DISCOMs come for with their power purchase agreements for approval, we have to see how much will be the forecasted load. How do we tailor our power procurement to the load profile of the DISCOM, load curve of the DISCOM, and the projected load demand?
Right, ma'am. Right.
These are some of the regulatory challenges I can think of.
Yes, very technical challenges and very simply explained by you, ma'am. Thank you for that. And ma'am, if this would bring us to our next question, you have elucidated very well what are the regulatory challenges and what could be the possible solutions, ma'am, that experts such as yourselves can offer. And do you think the Forum of Indian Regulators can play a role in offering these solutions?
Okay. Well, you know, I think first I would like to highlight some solutions for these challenges. For example, you know, the regulators have to see how the intermittent and variable renewable energy can be integrated into the grid. So all the regulators should be able to bring out forecasting and scheduling regulations, put in place the accounting system for all the renewable energy sources as well as the conventional generation sources, and the DISCOM which is buying the power, so that the grid discipline is maintained and each and every source and load is monitored. Then having adequate flexibility in the grid will become very important in the future. So having, you know, tie-ups with the reservoir type hydro stations, having flexible generating stations where they can go up and down, and you know, if the thermal has to go up and down, then it incurs a lot of extra. The station heat rate goes up, the auxiliary consumption goes up, so regulators need to allow that in the tariff to the generating station, where the regulator has to look at possible storage solutions, maybe battery, maybe compressed air and other solutions, but these should be cost effective. You know, the regulator has also the challenge of passing these costs to the consumer. So all these solutions have to be looked at in terms of cost and benefit. I think the solution is also to have time of use tariff to encourage consumption during peak solar hours. For example, when there is more of solar energy, then we should have time of use tariff so that people move to peak solar time for their needs. And I would say this is about renewable energy, but in keeping tariffs reasonable, we need to rationalize cross subsidy. There has been a general tendency to, you know, load the commercial consumers and the industrial consumers. But I feel that if industry is to be retained in India, then the cross subsidy should be rationalized, and each consumer should be able to, which we are not able to do because of the cross subsidization. But gradually, we are attempting to reduce the cross subsidy as far as possible. And you know, I think in tariffs we should introduce performance based incentives. You know, if the we should share the gains with the DISCOM. What happens is the losses are always given to the DISCOM, but the gains are never shared with the DISCOM. Right. So to my mind, you know, if they are to perform better, then the gains of their improved performance should be shared between the customer, consumer or customer and the DISCOM. And then I would say the best solution would be smart metering and digitalization of the operations of the utility. Many private firms have been able to do that, but we need to bring this digitalization of entire activity of the DISCOM. We need to digitalize it and then bring it to ERP solutions and other solutions, so that, you know, they perform more efficiently. Tariff is a function of the cost, and if the utilities are digitalized, they are likely to perform better. They will have better information, better data, and data mining always helps in improving your performance. So we should have experts who are both IT as well as distribution experts, especially in the distribution sector. We have enough generation, we have adequate transmission capacity, and distribution is the weakest link. So there we need to introduce performance-based incentives. Right. And the FOIS can help because, you know, it has got the experience of so many infrastructure regulators. So it is a body of infrastructure regulators. So the best practices across various sectors can be shared and implemented in the various sectors. The experience gained in other sectors can be put to use in power sector. And for example, power sector is moving towards de-licensing as being proposed. So in case of de-licensing, how to implement ceiling tariffs, how to see various licensees, various entities, I would say, not licensed. We are moving towards de-licensing possibly in the proposed amendments. So how to implement ceiling tariffs and competition in this sector? So competition has been implemented in aviation and telecom, in other infrastructure sectors. How to bring that into distribution sector in India? That, I think, experiences that shared in the power sector would really help. FOIR can act as the catalyst to guide power sector in implementing that.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And it is our attempt to bring all of you experts at one platform where more discussion, more brainstorming can happen and more solutions will emerge, ma'am. And you have rightly pointed out, you know, that the business growth environment has to be, you know, catered to through these solutions, and digitalization has its advantages. There is data mining that can take place. You're absolutely right, ma'am. You have sort of discussed the major concerns that are involved in the electricity sector in India. Would you like to elaborate more on that, ma'am, along with the solutions that you propose for these issues? Over to you, ma'am.
Well, you know, as I said, we have in a lot of generation capacity. The shortages in generation are no longer there. They are very minimal. Whatever shortage is there at the consumer end is because of the transmission and distribution system, mainly due to the breakdowns in the distribution system or the DISCOMs not procuring enough power. We have adequate transmission system, almost adequate transmission system now. But it is the distribution sector which is facing most of the challenges. And the first challenge I feel, or the major concern in this, is the financial health of the DISCOM. How to improve the financial health of the DISCOM. And that's the most important thing. And you know, what I have found is that the financial health of DISCOM is poor due to large, you know, consumers not paying, high AT&C losses. Then also due to government departments, you know, local bodies, gram panchayats, they are not paying up their dues. And there are essential services which we cannot even disconnect. Though the regulations say you can disconnect them, but the DISCOM finds it very difficult because it would create a lot of hue and cry if you were to disconnect a water connection for non-payment of dues, or you know, the government department for non-payment of dues. So there has to be put in place a political will for, you know, payment of these dues. The DISCOM's financial health will improve when it gets subsidy on time, because like in Punjab, agriculture is subsidized. So the subsidy should be paid on time, and dues of large customers should be like government departments, etc., should be paid on time. And of course, AT&C losses have to be brought down. There are problems like in border areas, there are law and order problems. Money is not collected. There are meters installed, but they are not billed, or they are not, money is not collected. So maybe, you know, smart metering with remote reading and digitalization would be the solution. But the first thing I think is political will at these, you know, to address the law and order problem in collecting bills and metering is one of the issues that needs to be improved. Then, you know, I would say that is one challenge in improving the financial health. Secondly, you know, we need to ensure quality and reliability of power supply to the consumer. The electronic equipment in the system is increasing like anything, and in COVID times, everybody is working from home, everybody is on Zoom, and everybody is on, you know, we have a lot of computer-based equipment which is injecting harmonics into the system, voltage issues. So quality regulations need to be put in place so that even losses will also reduce, as well as supply quality of supply to the consumer will increase. So we need to have our regulations in place and ensure that the polluters who are injecting pollution into the system, like harmonic, etc., should be controlled. Then I would again say that inadequate digitalization of the system, especially in public utilities. You know, we don't have solutions of software based, and we are struggling with even billing. If everything is digitalized, smart metering is in place, prepaid metering is in place, but that is the challenge for the regulator as to how to pass on the cost of these smart meters to the consumers. Smart meters in place. We have invested in those meters. So the regulator has to put in place a plan where, you know, smart meters are put where they are needed, and the benefit from this incurred smart metering. That smart metering is required, digital is required, but how to go about it, the roadmap needs to be put in place. Then, you know, load forecasting is another issue with the DISCOMs. You know, in this case, scenario of renewables and power, variable power, the load and the generation profiles have to be matched. And this is where, you know, resource adequacy as well as load forecasting has to be matched. In DISCOMs, most load forecasting is done by, you know, CAGR method, compounded annual growth, or applying growth rates. But that needs to be refined more so that the load is forecast adequately and the generation to match that is procured more efficiently. And if the DISCOMs do have PPAs where, you know, power has to be surrendered, especially in case of thermal stations, we are running our state plants at 20 to 30%. So the DISCOMs have to be able to sell that additional power to the in the exchange so that they are able to recover some of their fixed costs as well as the variable cost. So that would be one thing which, you know, would be a solution. Adequate forecasting and selling of and buying and selling of power, because power costs are the 80% of the cost of a in the tariff, 70 to 80%. So if we are efficient in power procurement as per our load, then I think can bring down costs. Then, you know, one thing I would like to stress upon is capacity building at grassroots level in a DISCOM.
Yes, sir.
That is missing in most of the DISCOMs. You know, people who are at the grassroots level are either overburdened or they are, you know, not really paying adequate attention to their work. They need to be motivated and also educated about the regulations and what has to be done. To ensure, you know, customer experience and customer satisfaction. Most people have this that, you know, when they do go to a DISCOM, they are very dissatisfied. Even if you don't get a remedy, you know, your bill may be correct, your meter may be correct. You feel that it is not correct. The DISCOM should be able to satisfy yourself, you, that yes, the meter is correct or the bill is correct. So that, you know, we need to build capacity at the grassroots level in the DISCOM. And secondly, we need to have people who have both IT experience as well as distribution related experience. You know, mostly solutions are IT based, but IT doesn't know distribution and distribution people do not know IT. So we need an amalgamation of both. We need to build professionals right from the beginning who have both IT and distribution experience. So now we should take people who are IT savvy as well as would like to work in distribution. That is one thing I would like to say. And well, anything, as I said, digital is most important.
Thank you for throwing light, ma'am, on these issues. And as we come to an end, ma'am, we would like to ask you that what inspired you to be who you are today? And did you face any challenges as a, if I may, a woman regulator, or is there even a term such as a woman regulator?
Okay. Well, you know, as you said, I have worked in Central Electricity Authority in the generation, transmission, distribution, renewables, load forecasting, and making regulations. So our experience, the feedback we had at CEA was that though regulations are made at the central level, it is very difficult to get them implemented at the grassroots level. You know, it is the CEA does not have the wherewithal to get these implemented. It is the state electricity regulatory commissions which get these regulations and standards implemented. So I was very much interested in going to a state electricity regulatory commission to see how these can be implemented. And secondly, I'll be frank that as a consumer, I found the power tariffs very high, my bills very high. So I wanted to go to an electricity commission and see how tariffs are fixed and how we can reduce these tariffs. That has been my point of interest now also. I went to Delhi Electricity Regulatory Commission as Director Engineering, and I had additional charge of Director Tariff also. So I basically learned everything about tariff and engineering and how these standards can be implemented in Delhi Electricity Regulatory Commission. And I came to PSERC, Punjab State Electricity Regulatory Commission. And well, as a woman regulator, I think when you go to a new commission, it is the challenge of being accepted as a technocrat and a regulator. You know, you have to make, you know, people do not first accept you. So you have to be work twice as hard, I would say, than a man to get yourself accepted.
Yes, ma'am.
But the background of DERC as well as Central Electricity Authority, the challenge for me was not so much. I was an MBA as well as a technocrat, and had seen regulation at first hand by working at grassroots level in DERC. So it was easier for me in the regulatory space. I think the challenge is in getting new ideas accepted in a set pattern of working. Yes, ma'am. When you join a commission, you bring a lot of new ideas to the table. For example, I had seen what happens in DERC, in CEA, I had seen what happens to in other DISCOMs. So bringing those ideas to Punjab Regulatory Commission, that took time, but I think the challenge was worth it, and I have really tried to make a difference in what happens in my commission.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And there's so much more that we would like to talk to you about, but because of the paucity of time, this we'll have to call it a day here. But it has been absolutely fabulous, ma'am, talking to you. Thank you for sparing your time. And please keep showering your blessings and your good wishes on us, because this interview is actually going to add so much value to the Regulatory Digest newsletter. Thank you for being with us, ma'am. Thank you. Looking forward.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah. I hope it was okay.